I'm really happy to be here, happy to be invited. So my name is Navid Zamani. I am the director of the Masters of Arts in Education Counseling in the Counseling and School Psychology Department, as well as I teach in the MFT program, the Marriage and Family Therapy program there, as well as a counseling minor. I fiddle here and there with the honors program. So I have my finger in a couple places, but generally it's all kind of thematically guided by counseling and kind of the mostly art and a little bit of science that we call counseling. And so some of my history and my context and my work is that I come, my specialty is strongly in domestic violence. So I work closely with domestic violence services in San Diego. So in that context, I'm really interested in the ways that we make sense of people and the ways that we interview and question folks and how to kind of manage all the factors that go into a conversation, particularly when there's a lot of stress. Yeah. And so my understanding here, and I'm kind of curious to hear from you folks, and I'll check in with you all in a second, is that I'm here to kind of convey some, perhaps, skills around how we might interview or be in relational context with folks where we're kind of curious to know more about whatever it is, whether it's helping them fix something or just get a better sense of how they're understanding something. And if you're in a context where you're supporting someone in completing a task or something, you know that sometimes like anxiety can be a pretty present factor. So if it's okay with you, I was hoping that we could kind of go around the room. If you could just share your name, kind of whatever seems relevant contextually about you here, and perhaps how interviewing skills show up in your life or work. We can start anywhere and we'll just go around. Yeah.
I'm David Potting. I'm a state employee here. Work with the department, the video production area. And we do a lot of assessment by meeting and greeting people in this department. So whether they have an immediate need, which they express to us, or they may not know what they need, and we have to coax it out of them. But we have a tendency to be people-oriented and trying to draw people into how we can define our service, the faculty and the community.
Thanks, Dave. You can go whatever direction.
Go ahead. Hi, I'm Michelle. I'm a student assistant here, and at the ITS Video Department, we have to learn how to interview a lot of students or professors for any video needs that they want.
Thanks.
I'm Kyle Sechel. I also work here, and guess a lot of client-facing experience and working with other staff members.
Thanks.
My name is Bon Wu. I work here on a learning space area. We deal with professor every day. Stress, nice professor, sad professor, happy professor.
All types.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
I work at Instructional Technology Services. A lot of the stuff we do is interviewing. So it's dealing with the stress of the person who's maybe not used to being on camera, but also dealing with the behind-the-scenes technical stuff. So working with people who perhaps aren't technically skilled, but needing to come together as a team behind the scenes and in front of the camera.
Yeah, technical stuff can raise our blood pressure pretty quick sometimes.
Sure.
Thanks.
So I'm James Frizzi. I also work here at ITS. We do a lot of kind of front-end analysis when working with faculty to help them meet their needs. So kind of trying to understand the audience of, you know, who's going to take advantage of a particular tool, for instance, that we're supporting requires a lot of listening. So very interested in learning more.
Great, thanks.
My name is Tom. I'm a student assistant at ITS. I do development operations work, but I'm also an academic mentor in the residence halls, dealing with freshmen and being a primary crisis responder.
Well situated. Thank you.
I'm Rudy Arias. I manage projects here for our department, so not necessarily interviewing, but I guess my type of interviewing is working with my fellow colleagues and making sure, you know, I'm understanding, you know, what their needs consulting around campus.
I'm Eric Zentmeyer. I'm here in the video department, and we, like my colleagues said, do a lot of interviewing. I love doing interviewing, but a lot of times it can be difficult. Sometimes people aren't comfortable in front of the camera, sometimes they don't have time, and sometimes they just can't break out of the academic mold and get personal with us. And so trying to break down those barriers through conversation and through listening is something I want to learn more about.
My name is Ethan Garcia. Pretty much close to what Eric said. We do a lot of interviews in video production, and it's kind of hard to get a truthful approach to it. But a lot of times it can seem like the person's answering the question in a very like academic, just not like personable way.
Mm.
So yeah, breaking down barriers and all that stuff.
So how do we move from intellectualizing to more talking from experience, perhaps?
Yeah, exactly. More like anecdotal.
Hi, Kiro Tosaku. Actually, what everybody's said, I'm part of, which is great. We have a good team. Interact also with staff besides faculty on coaching and using technology. And for example, right now it was the plumber, so I can tell you all about it.
Okay.
It's happening, in our building. So I work with everybody on campus too as well, which is good. And it's a great place to work here because we have very strong personal people skills, and the faculty will come to us, for example, not just about technology, but to tell us what's happening in their department and the politics that's going on there, which helps to know the person. And also their interests.
Great, thank you. So in this community, it seems like interviewing is a fairly influential action, that it can take people in the very different directions, particularly in front of the camera. I'm thinking of your story. And as a counselor, and I want to kind of liken this to interviewing, that what I'm doing as a counselor is basically interviewing. And in my line of work, I consider myself and what we do as being a question smith. That through my ability to kind of listen and understand someone's stories, I might be able to construct a question that fits particular needs or guides in specific directions. Yeah. So that's a really specific skill that's picked up over time. When it comes to kind of talking about counseling skills and kind of these relational skills, it's really tough to show up with like a PowerPoint and say these are the skills that you need to do, and just go do them, and then you excel at them, because we all show up in like really different places with these skills, where some of us might be more comfortable in front of the camera, and others might not be, So it's, I really liken, and I was saying like it's more art than science, I really liken this process to playing music, like improvisational music, like jazz particularly, where I show up with a set of skills that perhaps I've practiced or I've thought about or studied, and I'm prepared to adapt with those skills and maneuver in whatever context that is presented to me. Yeah? So I'm hoping that today we might be able to kind of lean into some activities that I'm hoping will drive the points home and also create a context where you might be able to reflect on what is comfortable for me, what's not so comfortable, what are the things that I might want to consider doing different. Yeah? Because one of the things that I really think about in a counseling or interviewing context is that it's really blended in with the rest of our life, right? So when we go and study different fields, perhaps math or biology, it might be something that we're thinking about throughout the day, but it's not a practice that we might be doing all the time with people. Whereas interviewing, we're constantly doing. Like you mentioned, like you're constantly in a state of assessing people. That's something that's happening. Assessment is just a formal word for something we're constantly doing. And so in that way, I'm really interested in identifying what are our habits of relating? Like what things do we do because that's what we've been trained to do in our lives? And how are those things being helpful or not so helpful? And sometimes we come to a place where we realize some of our habits of relating aren't helping the purposes of this conversation. So would that be okay if we kind of lean into some of these activities? So In this context, I'm going to kind of have people pairing up and chatting with each other. I always promote what I call real play, where you might, if you're bringing forward whatever you're comfortable sharing from your own life experience, yeah? Because there's something that feels disingenuous about a role play and also can sometimes start diving into some stereotypes that I'm not so interested in perpetuating. So it'd be great if you could lean into that. And I want to offer the caveat of don't do anything you're uncomfortable with, don't share anything you're uncomfortable with. There's a camera here, so keep that in mind. So I just want to kind of lay the groundwork for that. Is that all okay? Are there any concerns as far as that goes? Okay. So if you all could just take a second and pair up with someone in this room that you might have a conversation with. And it looks like we're an even number. So in your pairs, self-select one person who's going to be the interviewee, the person responding, and the interviewer. And the topic, maybe this will help guide who's going to be the interview and interviewer. The topic is to talk about something or share about something. We're going to take 5 minutes or so. Share something that has been kind of an obstacle currently, whatever capacity, whether it's work, school, home life, relationships, something that you've been kind of going through and trying to find some solutions to, perhaps. Yeah?
The interviewer is sharing something?
Yes. And then the interviewer is going to interact with you in that context. So once you've selected that person, can the interviewers come with me outside for 1 second? So whatever is happening, I want you to show up in whatever way it means to like solve their issue. Okay, that's it.
Okay. So are they gonna speak to us about
yeah.
their issue?
Yeah. And so you're gonna open it up, and then you're gonna you can ask questions, you can offer advice,
are we
but
open it up. Tell me about your issue.
Yeah. About whatever ways you want.
So yeah,
listen.
This is
our assignment.
Okay.
And while you're doing this, like reflect on like how what the questions that you're choosing, the ways that you're showing up, some of the physiology that might be going on in that conversation.
Okay.
But the main goal in 5 minutes is for you to come to a solution. Cool?
So yeah,
five minutes to solve all the
so go ahead and chat for 5 minutes and I'll give you a warning for 1 minute, okay?
Clock is running.
So what kind of obstacles have you been through lately? Have you seen anyone else?
I think.
There's so much to do.
Awesome. So they're gone. I come back.
So trying to see where he's developing, you know, how he's finding how he's teaching. So it's hard to right now to find out how. I guess I already know, but.
So you want to just get it done.
Right.
So you're
going to want to get it done because like, I want to move on to the next thing.
So
he's having to do it because he's already tired or broke.
I have a hard time saying he's already done.
And then so it's like it's that finding that middle point with him of, and then we get into negotiations.
If you do one sheet,
wanting to kind of move forward. I'm feeling like if I don't sleep 7 minutes, I won't move forward.
I think the average sleep time.
Is this in that with your personal life and your professional life?
Like
just
you 6 to 7 hours.
Or
you want to shoot 5?
I think it ends up being both.
I think that's it.
I'm noticing mostly in my professional life recently. So.
What do you do?
I teach and I'm also
doing
that.
How much do you spend? I sleep around 10.
One guy who only promotes people at 7 years or older, and they can't sing anymore, they can't dance anymore, but it's really tough because
I think he likes to see,
so I end up like
the way it's done, and then he wants to replicate.
So understanding how he
some stress and need to be important around it.
Brand of watch.
Do you have any?
Oh yeah, we do.
Very smart.
Is that your partner? No.
No.
So I do think they're important. What was your question again? How do I feel?
Do you feel like they're busy?
Yes and no. Like, sometimes if it's going on for too long, it feels like busy work. Like, at the end of a long day, oh my god, I just did a lot of stuff.
But
I also like the job.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is something that I also struggle with. Delegating tasks. So for me, if something,
yeah.
And,
because I know,
I guess my issues are like, I'm pretty good at prioritizing and like finding out what I want first. It's just like, there's certain points.
But we did it. Yeah.
Like,
which is good.
It's like almost a form, I guess. So, I would love to hear some reflections and thoughts on how that was for you. I'd love to hear from the interviewees first. Who had their problem solved? Noah? Kind of. Let's kind of hear some reflections from you interviewees.
I have a suggestion.
Were you interviewed or the interviewer?
I was the interviewer.
Okay. How was that experience for you?
Oh, it was okay. Okay. I laid out what the situation was, and they said, well, you know, have you ever tried using like social media to get your problem solved, because you can get a wider group and also plan farther ahead instead of 60 days, like plan 120 days ahead and see if you can get people to commit. I said the biggest thing is if you're not paying them or providing food or whatever, they can just come the last week and say, no, I'm not going to show up.
So do you feel like you walked away with a solid solution?
Hmm?
Do you feel like you're leaving the conversation with a solution to your problem?
Got some new things to think about.
Thanks. Others?
So mine was positive. It was a lot of just making sure I set hard deadlines on things that I promised to do, and relay that to the other person that these things are going to get done on time.
Thanks.
Yeah, mine had to do with the passing away of my dog, who was suffering from for 2 years this disease. It's equivalent to Lou Gehrig's disease, and so. You know, you go through that process of mourning and grieving, but it was good that Ethan, you know, asked me, well, how did I get through that period of time? But what I realized is, you know, having a good support group of friends, you know, and then also helping their pets out, you know, visiting them. And then one of my friend's friend introduced me to somebody who is, her dog is going through the same thing, so I can, through my experience, share and help her.
So did he give you solutions or did you give yourself solutions?
He gave me some solutions too. No, we because of our interaction and talking and then asking me how did I do it or what am I doing? So no.
And
it was a
And I'm being playful with my abrasive questioning of that. So interviewers, how was that experience? Did you feel connected and present and able to support your client?
I think what we found was that for Carol, it wasn't necessarily me saying you need to do this, you need to do this, but it's looking at what you're already doing and how you can change that, or what you should keep doing, what you should stop doing.
So you were interested in how she was managing it, rather than you providing some
resources. Yeah, because I couldn't say, well, this is what I would do, but I rather wanted to say, well, what are you doing right now?
He's a good listener.
That sounds like that.
And compassionate.
So my, the way I approached it is, she told me a solution, and I just gave her what I would do too, and gave her an idea how to split the work on how to deal with it throughout the day. Just ideas, support.
So you're drawing on your own experiences?
Yeah, yeah. That's what I would do. Maybe she'll pick up on there and just go.
My client was already finding his way to the solution, and I sort of just served as a reaffirmation of that he was sort of taking the right steps. And listening to sort of the problem and what he was doing and reaffirming that you know, he was kind of taking the right steps.
So let me ask this for you interviewers. Did you feel like you were pretty hard at work in that process?
I felt obligated to really help get a solution. You know, like really want to help them leave with a good positive, you know, way to help work through the problem.
Somehow, I just kept asking a question. It just popping up, just keep asking. And maybe we just came up with some ideas too.
Yeah. So part of my hope and intention with this exercise is kind of keying into the experience of giving advice, right? It sets up some specific constructs in that conversation, in the relationship, right? There's a sense of obligation and responsibility. So if this person doesn't leave happy, so we have different measures of what success is, right? If this person doesn't leave happy, or if they're not calm during this conversation, then I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. It also sets up a context where Now I'm, as an interviewer, working really hard to find solutions, yeah? And like your kind of experience really highlights beautifully is that often, and this happened in my interview, where people offer me advice, and I'll say, well, I've already tried that. Well, I did that, right? And it's this really draining type of conversation, right? And when we're thinking about the context of wanting someone to be comfortable, wanting someone to be calm, however we're defining that, right? If we're wanting someone to be responsive to what we're talking about, like a draining and like soul-sucking type of conversation is kind of the opposite of that, yeah? So one thing that we say in counseling is that if you're working really hard, there might be some things to shift, right? Because the hope is that your client is a person who's coming to some understandings, right? And I'm thinking about in an IT context, for example, where someone is coming to you with issues with their computer. And I've had experiences where, you know, I'm not like I wouldn't call myself an IT guy, but I'm pretty familiar with technology. So usually I've gone through a pretty robust set of troubleshooting methods. And so the IT guy comes over and he's like, well, you try restarting it? Of course, that's the first thing I did, right? And so it sets up the relationship in a very specific way, yeah? So now, if it's okay, we're gonna switch roles. And we're gonna have the same topic, but the interviewer, your task, is to not respond with anything but silence. That is all you're gonna do.
Oh, great.
Can you hum?
Do we switch
roles?
No. Well, are we switching roles?
Yeah, you're switching roles. So now the interviewee is the interviewer, and the interviewer is the interviewee.
Are we having the same problem, or have our own problem, different problem?
Well, if you're switching, hopefully you can, same topic, yeah. Same topic, so like, something that you've overcome and been challenging.
Oh, okay, I was like, what am I
doing? Oh, yeah. Leading into your own lived experiences, yeah?
So we're like playing the same.
Yeah. So your topic, like last group, is something that you've been trying to overcome and work on, and your interviewer's role is to just be silent and listen. Listen in silence, however that looks. Okay?
Are we allowed to have eye contact?
Facial expressions?
Yeah. Listening in silence, however that looks. Yeah.
Body language?
Whatever you're drawn to doing, I'm leaving my instructions at silence. And you deal with that. So in this, as you're going along, please pay attention to your physiology and what's coming up for you. Okay? We're going to do 5 minutes.
Struggling with this because I'm kind of trying to reconnect with my past. And I don't know. Start procrastinating.
It's a lot.
We're words don't come out. You're pushing this question of what comes out of that feel genuine. So, you know, then I just set it aside and then I come back to it. Still not getting that, you know. So I've been struggling with that. And like last night, finally, I kind of made those final breakthroughs, and I've got like pretty much got it where you know, I just need to find genius. But it's weird. It's just
from the interviewer, the silent folks. How was that for you? What were you noticing?
It was hard not to say anything.
Say more about that. Like, what was hard about it?
Because when she was reflecting, I wanted to reflect with her, but I wasn't sure if I was able to like reaffirm by nodding or anything. So I was just kind of like, I want to say something, but I can't.
Is there a way that you might describe that physiology in your body, that like difficult hardness with that verge?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of what I was saying. It's just because I wanted to share to her that she's not crazy. Like, it's, you know, I see it too. She's not crazy, and it's just like, how do I can't say anything. So it's just kind of tough there.
It was interesting because Ethan did do a lot of talking, but I did use some gestures which he could understand.
Like sign language or what?
Not exactly sign language. He was saying something like what his obstacle was. I would go like.
What would it have been like to not do that at all? What would that have been like for you?
It would have been okay.
Yeah.
I would just have probably meditated and not even listened. They would have gone one way and the other.
That's interesting. So, not being able to respond in some ways had you disengage a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm actually the opposite because I felt a little awkward because I didn't want to make him feel that I wasn't paying attention. So I just wanted to make sure that I had eye contact with him and then nod when I could. And I really felt like, well, at least to me, my personality, like I had a lot of questions and it's just like I was trying to jump out of my body and ask him, but I can't.
So you felt really activated.
Yeah.
In your body to engage with this story.
Yeah, because he was sharing a story that's I think we're both very familiar with that I've been through, and so I just kind of wanted to give him some of my personal experience.
A big part for me, at least, of the active listening is just giving those like small of encouraging words, like "Tell me more. How does that make you feel?" Or you were telling about your sister, like "What's her name? Make her a person." And not being able to ask those questions and provide you like support and like a little bit of comfort is hard.
How would you describe that experience in your body?
A little trapped, sort of like I want to help you, but I can't.
Like suffocating.
Yeah. So then.
Yeah, I experienced the same. I felt it was frustrating to not be able to affirm what he was saying and ask him more.
Interview,
go ahead, you want to finish with?
No, I was just going to ask for reflections from the interviewees.
In mentally, I had to think of, am I more in a mirror situation where they're saying things and they're just being reflected back, or am I more of a bucket, or whatever you want to call it, a well, where they're just pouring. The language is just being poured into me, and what do I do as far as expressions and things like that? And then both of those concepts are hard for me because I have a tendency to be a verbal person, but I want to respond and not just mirror that thing. I don't want to be a barrier.
I love those metaphors, and I would posit that you're both. And in the context of social constructionism where knowledge is created right here, right, it comes out and then it's formed in this middle ground that you're both a mirror and a bucket, and maybe something else in there too. A shovel, maybe some hammers. And, yeah. Interviewees, some reflections?
I thought it was interesting because I'm not a big talker, so I was a little uncomfortable with the idea at first. And I have to talk for 5 minutes and I'm not going to have any cues to bounce off of. But when you're sitting there and you're just all you're doing is reflecting on your own ideas, suddenly I found it a lot easier. And as an interviewer, that makes me think about our interjections, how they may affect the way that someone might take take their reflections, take their thoughts when we're doing interviews.
Would it be fair for me to, in that context, name interruption as a skill? Like the act of interrupting as a very decisive skill in shaping the conversation?
Sure.
That's what I'm throwing in there. Alex, that's interesting.
Yeah, so for me, I felt uncomfortable talking to her just because I'm not a big talker too. And I need a path to talk. I need her to show me hey, ask me questions so I can answer.
Uh-huh.
So I was just uncomfortable.
So you're uncomfortable as an interviewee as well?
Yeah.
And it was her, it was like kind of a sense of I don't know where to go in this conversation.
Yeah, so I needed her to ask me and to leave me.
Thanks. Anyone else? Yeah.
So you were a bucket for me. But I knew he was listening, which is comforting because I'm not a big talker either. So it's like all these things that are usually just in my head, I have finally said out loud, and to have someone hear it was nice. But I was really uncomfortable because I didn't have kind of someone to affirm that I'm not crazy, like you know what I'm saying, or emotional or something. And I was kind of just stuck with my own thoughts still. So yeah.
Shame that. So part of my hope with this exercise is not trying to suggest that you should do that, right? Yeah, because it can be uncomfortable for our interviewee. But what I'm kind of suggesting is it can be equally uncomfortable to say nothing as it is to say something, depending on your client and what they're showing up for. Yeah, and like your point was really poignant in the sense that what we bring forward shapes what someone might share. And often the interviewer's experience is quite different from the interviewee's. Where I might be, as an interviewer, sitting there with a lot of anxiety, like, they gotta talk, they gotta do this, I'm kind of like floating in this world of like things that I need to do with them. And someone might be sharing something and lost in thought. And what feels like 50 minutes for me could be like a second for someone else's experience. Yeah? So, in addition to that our bodies, if you notice, are trained to want to respond. Like, we're relational creatures. Our brains are created to be social and relational. And so when we're in a context where we're not able to do those habits of relating, our body starts freaking out. Because our body wants to lean in and do things. And often we're guided by just our body first, in some ways. Yeah. So it's like, they're uncomfortable. And this, it can be impacted in with a lot of different discourses, right? So like, a traditional way to think about a gendered way of showing up for men, if someone's emotional or crying, my experience with training counselors, particularly men, is like we want to step in and say, you're okay, and solve it so that they're not uncomfortable. Because discomfort is really uncomfortable for us, me, right? So really tuning into like, what is it that you're doing that's helpful and not so helpful, and choosing that, right? Not letting your body choose it for you. And often it requires some practice of going against the grain, like weird setups like this, where you're not responding to someone, you're like, oh God, this is so awkward. But it highlighting those things that you might want to do differently, yeah? So I want to check the time here, because I want to do something else. 15 minutes, okay? Keep going, Bob?
Yeah, 2 minutes.
Everyone doing okay? Hang on there? All right. So just a couple skills to think about before I go into this next activity are things like encouragers. So taking a word and like underlining it and saying like, I'm curious about this word. So you mentioned sadness. Sadness? Just repeating the word. It can be a question in and of itself, right? Paraphrases. So part of a counselor's role, and I really think like in IT, in any context where you're interviewing, it's to get really what we call experience near. So situating ourselves really closely to the story that someone is sharing, right? And that requires an intentional act of using their language, really trying to understand the meanings and not making any assumptions about what people say. And that can look kind of surprising sometimes, where in conversation, someone might be sharing to me about their experience of anxiety. Do you like anxiety? Right? I'm not gonna assume that you like or don't like anxiety because I don't know how it shows up in your life, right? So really pausing for the assumptions we make constantly on a daily basis, on a word per word basis, yeah? So for this next piece, let's get into groups of three or four, whatever works, and let's get around like a table, if that's okay.
There we go. Come on over.
So I'm going to get into some little bit more abstract theoretical ideas. So hang with me, and then I'll explain what's going on at the end, if that's okay. So for this next piece, one person in your group is to self-select someone who has a smartphone of any kind, and ideally it's someone who's having a real issue with your smartphone. Usually there's at least one person in a group of four that's having an issue with their smartphone. And if not, you can make it up. And so the task. So the task of everyone else. So once you've selected the person who's got the phone, the task of the rest of the group is to figure out the problem, but you cannot use common terminology. So you can only, like, instead of, and you can't say apps or home screen or home button or anything like that, right? You can only lean into descriptions of what it is, right? Does that make sense? Anyone confused? Let's do that for like.
I can't think of a problem.
Yeah. Let's do that for like 3 to 4 minutes. Okay. So go ahead and try that out.
themselves. So I have to be that person that doesn't know how to use a
smartphone.
Yeah. Sure. Sure.
And a phone isn't relevant, try something else.
Oh, laptop?
All right. But no, by not using common terminology. So no screen or keyboard or anything.
Oh, okay.
That is descriptions.
It won't do that.
No.
You can describe it, you just can't use common terminology.
Does it have to do with...
In a way, yes.
Okay. Is the magic light on
something you're not used to, or is it something
you've
done?
I think you can say I have a laptop with that. Describe your problem.
Oh, okay, so I should say something like that.
So I have a laptop, and the communication with the information is the highway feature.
The what?
That's good. The part that connects to the world. To other computers, there are a number of different ways to connect to that. And because sometimes when I connect away from the central hub that provides the connection to the world, I can do it remotely through my phone. But this particular device is not connected directly.
Is it something related to the amount of pressure you're putting on it? Is it relative to?
I don't know, because what I've noticed is if I try to do it a certain different way, then my pressure shows up. Do you know how you can use Yeah, and so if I'm holding it and it's not responding fast enough, like usually in the morning when I'm playing music through it, and a Bluetooth speaker, and then I go touch my fingers and I want to open my phone up because when I get to be the hardest time, and then I push, like I guess maybe I come down, or I don't know how to get the credit card to show up, but it does all the time. I know it's not true. And so I'm like, I don't want to pay for something, I just want to open my phone up and check something.
Are you out of your new space by chance? Do you have a lot of other devices running?
Not too
bad. I have a lot of things.
No, that's not because the device is too old.
Do you notice if it's a phone versus...
Yeah.
It may be an issue. Good question.
Yeah.
Well, at work, I'm able to connect directly to the
sports car.
Basically, the issue is that I sometimes use the garage for a home office.
Reset the whole thing, like
I grab it, it's too far out of the computer.
To restart. I think did that when I first had the emails.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
You would put all those things someplace else,
they're
and they feel like you were watered.
What's
the
cloud?
Right.
They're in some magical universe somewhere, all stored for me.
We're glad it's all wrapping up.
But yeah,
But I didn't need to do that.
Maybe somebody.
So go ahead and wrap up.
Yeah, because there weren't that similar.
Right.
Well, that's why I wanted to connect directly to it.
My dad used to have a cell phone.
All right, y'all.
Yeah.
Sorry to cut you short. So who solved the problem?
We solved it.
Anyone solve their problem?
Yep. We did several ways.
Paul, you fix it?
Yeah.
Nice.
Fixed? No, we couldn't recreate it, so it's hard to solve it when you can't recreate it.
Of course,
it
doesn't happen when you need it to, right? And any luck over here?
Two possible solutions. We got tripped up with the terminology.
Yeah, I'd love to hear, how was that experience of not using common terminology?
It was like running up against a bunch of roadblocks and trying to find the way around.
Yeah.
I felt like you were just beating around the bush when we knew what it was. Mm.
What types of questions were you finding yourselves asking him?
Like emotional questions.
What do you mean?
Like I asked him like how he felt knowing, that he was disconnected from his.
problem.
Was that important to solving his problem?
Yeah, because he's actually doing either personal work or actual work that needs to get accomplished.
So you were trying to assess the level of like intensity mm-hmm. that he was experiencing this problem?
Yeah.
Yeah, and whether he experienced it at work versus at home.
Mm.
You know, and what were the differences?
And did that make a difference in the solution that you offered?
Yeah, it did.
Others, how was your experience of solving or not solving the problem and kind of being in those questions?
Well, I think because I couldn't recreate the problem, so they couldn't really help me with it, was frustrating. Because it's like, no, I'm telling you, it's doing that. And then I'm saying, but then sometimes in the morning it does this thing, and they're looking at me like, I'm like, I swear it does.
What types of questions were you finding yourselves asking her? If you can think of any.
Maybe a past phone, if it's ever happened to her before, mm-hmm. kind of. My experience with smartphones mm-hmm. and how familiar I am with this type of device.
Right. What have you tried or not tried? Right. So, are folks okay if we stay like 5 minutes longer than 2, like 2:05?
Yeah.
Is that okay with everyone? All right. So, I'm going to pass around Legos, and I'm going to put a pile in the middle, and each person take their own little pile. So each person should have a little pile in front of them.
I don't want those to get mixed up in mine. I don't want them to lose it.
What? Oh, these are his. Oh, no, okay. Well, then keep them in there. So each person should have a little pile in front of them. If you could break some of the
world.
Okay. So your task here. Your task here is to select one person. Did you have these two people?
Yeah, we lost.
Does someone mind coming over here so that we can just even out the tables a little bit? Thank you. So one person.
I know.
A team player.
All right, so real quick, y'all. So one person is going to be self-selected as the creator. So you're the one that's going to be making something. The only rule is that the creator cannot talk. Everyone else can ask questions and provide support, however that looks, in helping them create their piece. And you can borrow pieces from other people's pile. And ideally, you do use something from everyone's pile, but it is up to you to create something. And then I'll check in with in about 5 minutes on what your creation is. Okay? And so everyone else's, you can talk, whatever. We got to support them in making it. Anyone unclear?
So we can talk.
Yeah, so is he the creator?
So the support team.
Yes, she can. So you guys are
doing? Can we offer pieces?
What are you thinking?
Just wait.
Can
we offer pieces to the creator for support?
Yeah, you can do whatever you want. The only rule is that he can't talk.
Somewhere
I got a nice nose piece.
Is it something practical or is it something
somewhere here? I got a cockpit.
Oh,
you need a
connector? Attach it, connect it.
We're on now. But there's no.
Is it food related?
We should use these
like an axle.
Weird egg things for our creation.
I'm going to put the axe on it.
Yeah, he needs
the axe.
Can you tell us something? Yeah. Mm.
Is it going to hold?
Is it a doll?
Oh, it's getting bigger. That's good.
It's getting bigger.
Missy!
Take a couple more minutes, like 2 minutes.
Any wheels or something?
I just want to find this.
Now you can drive his friend around.
Is it like a
phone?
What about this one?
Is it something you enjoy?
Take one more minute.
Is it seasonal?
You want to have some more friends?
There's another one.
Party wagon?
Yeah.
Is it road?
Is that Patrick Star?
Is it...
Is it something tangible?
All right. So you can keep creating if you want, but I'm going to kind of check in with you all and I'd love to hear some reflections. If I could, if you don't mind sharing, maybe we'll start with this group. What have you got for us?
We have a Ferrari with a, pulling a trailer.
Nice.
Something you won't see.
Wow.
On the road.
So share a little bit about your process here, how you came to that and how just, your group mates kind
well,
of
Well, I first started, there was... This one was already a little pre-built, and then we just started adding people, and then somehow they passed over an axle, and then I decided, well, how are we going to attach it? I'll just do a little trailer. And I think as I started building, they were kind of seeing my thought process and started putting, throwing stuff together.
So as you were starting to kind of make sense of it, they started noticing and offering things that might fit?
Yeah. I think they started seeing the shape, and then they just created or added to the creation.
Wonderful, thank you. Any reflections from the group members?
Really good children.
How was that for you all? Did you feel like you were able to support them?
Yeah.
We kind of just asked and showed the piece, and then he tried it, and if it didn't work, then we tried another piece.
You asked and showed the piece, and he was taking it.
Yeah.
Very visual. It was like all visual communication. You know? It was kind of like, it was almost like we didn't even need to talk. We could have just been like,
Yeah, so just by like offering it, it was like clear what the communication there was. Thanks. How about over here?
Carol asked some really good questions about how the object would make people feel, which is good. will this object make you happy? And I was like, yeah.
Do you have a name for that, or?
This is Minty Dog.
Oh,
it's
her dog.
It's a dog. Yeah.
Oh, that's cute. How was the process of kind of coming to that, and how was it for you guys supporting her and making that?
Yeah, it was just trying to get in her head
to see what she was thinking and what she was trying to feel for. So it was just because we know her, it was kind of easier to see what she was thinking.
So there was something about the connection you had and having a sense of maybe where she was going with that that allowed you to support her.
Right.
Great. Thanks. How about over here?
Is it a bunker? I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
But
it's very ecological.
It's a bunker where, you know, soldiers hide to fight and he just shot someone's head off.
You were the creator, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How was that process for you? Don't mind describing it.
It was cool. I didn't know what I was doing. They just encouraged and said, just keep putting stuff on it.
We just kept handing, like taking and stuff apart and handing her pieces and trying to section them off between, like, group them into different areas so she could find them quicker. And whatever she was thinking, she could possibly go to that area and find.
So something about organizing for her so she could find things.
Right. Yeah.
And you didn't know what you were starting out with, but then you kind of came to know something about it through this your groupmates.
Yeah. Right.
Great. Thank you all for sharing that. So kind of what I'm trying to highlight here is in counseling theories and the ways that this is an activity that I do with my students. And what I like about it is that it highlights two general kind of philosophies of thought around how we might think about someone's story and someone's life. Yeah, so in a systemic context where we're thinking about people's lives as systems, and that has a history and tradition in cybernetics and systems theories back in with Bateson in the 40s and 50s, where people and families are systems, and if you manipulate one part or the other part, it affects the whole system and things shift, right? Very similar to your phone. So when we're thinking about people or kind of conceptualizing things as systems, it motivates us to start asking specific types of questions, right? So now we're asking questions about troubleshooting. Have you tried this? Have you done that? What has worked? What hasn't worked, right? So it really guides it, kind of the, it creates a whole different well of types of questions that we might draw from, right? And so there's a really critical usefulness in that. Conversely, the other side of it is what we might call social constructionist theory, where knowledge is created in relationships and we come to know things through their pieces and the concepts. And so the Legos represent this idea where you might be able to engage with someone's story or the knowledge they have about their life as pieces. And you might be able to provide a piece and say, does this fit with what you're saying or does it not? And it encourages a whole different way of engaging with that thing. Right, so now we're not thinking about things as systems, we're interested in kind of knowing something with someone, right? And what sense they're making of it. And I notice folks trying to like get a description, like is that a car? Is that something you like, right? We're trying to like make sense of what that is. That really fits into scaffolding, Vygotsky's scaffolding work, where when we're trying to like take a look at the pieces of something, we might look at the little bits, so this is a blue block, this is a red block, and then we're examining how those pieces fit, and so now we're at concepts, and then from there we're linking up the concepts and how they fit in with each other, right? So that's a scaffolding type of conversation. So in these two contexts, sometimes you want to come from a systemic angle, and I imagine in an IT context or with an angry faculty member, you want to know what's not working and how to get to it. And sometimes it takes some listening and some leaning into the silence to get to where their phone is at, right? And I kind of had you not share about terminology because that highlights the importance and the usefulness of assumptions, right? That there are words that we share that we're all pretty sure of what that means. And sometimes that can be a barrier to understanding what the person is talking about, right? So in mental health, the button and the apps and the home screen, all these words translate to mental health diagnoses. It's like diagnoses help us communicate about what people might be experiencing. There's usefulness in that, and there's also some harm in that. And then in a constructionist context, I'm not interested in valuing or naming people's experiences, so the raw materials of their life, as much as I am interested in helping them make sense of what it is that they're putting together. Does that kind of make sense? Does the activity kind of highlight that experience? So I guess my takeaway is that you are the tool. You are the question smith, and the ways that you show up and the histories and the experiences you bring with you will shape that conversation. And folks, and conversations are shaping, right? For good or for bad. And that the ways that you choose to show up, and that I'm hoping that after this you might start thinking about some of those ways of showing up as choices, can influence your clients and your own lives. So maybe next time you're in a conversation with someone who's coming to you for support, maybe you might consider, do I want to think about this person's life as systems or maybe as Lego pieces? And how do I want to like support them in me being just here and present and listening? Yeah, because a lot of action happens in that silence and in the listening. And I always use the music metaphor. So in rhythm, what's more important than the notes is the space between the notes. And so really lean into silence as a tool and interruptions as critical, decisive moments. So I'm sorry that I went over time, but I really appreciate your time, so thank you all. Thank you. If you don't mind.